So we made it. Oh, we made it. We're on the top of Africa right now. And for most LGBT people, they don't have the freedom that we do in San Francisco. And we brought this and we wanted to put it up here as a way of saying that we're with you, that we know you're here, and we want you to know that we love you and you're our LGBT family.
Let's get high!
Meet Jenni and Lisa, a couple living in San Francisco. These two met in 2007 on the AIDS Life Cycle, a 500-mile bike ride from San Francisco to Los Angeles. In June of 2011, after 3 years of being together, Jenni and Lisa decided to quit their jobs and embark on a year-long journey to find the global leaders of the gay rights movement. Although neither had any experience with filmmaking, they decided to document their journey so they could share it with the world.
We are about to leave for a trip around the world, and this has been my dream for a really long time.
So when we're thinking about where to go, Jenni and I each wrote a list. We listed the places that we could afford, the places that we've been to that were special to us, that we wanted to share with one another. We're thinking that we want to choose places that have a variety of gay rights in the world.
And our goal is to look for lesbian, gay, and transgender leaders in these countries and talk to them.
I'm really excited to see other parts of the world because sometimes I think being from San Francisco and being American, we think we're number one in human rights or in gay rights, but we're really not. We can't get married. We don't have protection from discrimination around housing, around transgender rights, around joining the military. So we have a long way to go.
I think I'm drawn to the non-Western world in particular because as an Asian person, I feel like hearing someone who's from a non-Western culture talk about being gay and talking about it in a positive way, that it's just so much more impactful.
I really want to find stories of hope. I really want to find stories of inspiration. I want to find why I'm hopeful about change in the world. So let's have an adventure.
As Jenni and Lisa prepare to go on the adventure of a lifetime, they must also say goodbye to the people they love. In 2009, Lisa's father was diagnosed with dementia after suffering a stroke just a few years earlier. Lisa and her sister decided to move him to an assisted living home so he could receive around-the-clock care.
So you got your name tag?
I'm ready.
Do you remember what your room number is?
Yeah, 3 something.
Sorry, 330.
33.
And say goodbye. For the whole year, then.
Oh, my God. This year, this year?
Yeah, it's the last time I see you.
Oh, my God.
Huh?
Oh, my God.
We're gonna do okay.
Someone has always got someone, but that's never worked for me. Would you start over if true love was meant to be?
So, any advice for Jenni as she travels?
Any advice?
Don't trust anybody. If anybody wants to give you, ask me to carry something for them, say no. No.
So, honey, we just said goodbye to your parents. How was that?
Yeah. I'm really glad that they came to the airport. That was a big deal. They were a little tense today, but you know, they definitely pushed themselves, so I'm proud of them for showing up.
Jenni came out to her parents in 2006. Their conservative culture and religious views have made it difficult for them to accept Jenny's sexuality. They have yet to acknowledge Jenni and Lisa as a couple, even now as they're about to leave for their journey.
So we're in Auckland. We just landed. Our journey has begun, hour one. And I'm in this little car that feels like a go-kart. It feels like a video game. I'm driving a stick shift with my left hand on the opposite side of the road. And it's a little scary. So Jenny's our navigator.
Which means we're in big trouble because I can't even navigate when we're in San Francisco.
Our first day in Auckland, and we're here with Erwin Zimmet, and we just picked up the gay newspaper today, and look who was on the cover. So he's as good looking in person as in the newspaper. What's the best thing about gay life in New Zealand? I'm not so
good.
All right.
Yeah, like it's too small. It's like you seem to know everybody. That's, yeah. That's the biggest problem.
Yeah. Well, we actually... Oh, shit. It's a whip. Oh, my gosh. Just farted.
Oh, God. Lisa won't stop farting. Oh, my God. It really smells.
Bright, just like the stars above me. Proud, just like my mother.
Into a pole. I hate driving in New Zealand. It's no fun. Driving it with a clutch with my left hand and driving on the other side of the road.
New Zealand has legalized same-sex marriage and also allows gay couples to adopt children. New Zealand's Human Rights Act of 1993 outlaws discrimination on the grounds of sexuality. This act allows for gays to serve openly in the military. The New Zealand Defence Force has been assessed as the most LGBT inclusive military in the world. Here we meet Tom and Stuart, two active servicemen consulting the US military with the upcoming repeal of Don't Ask, Don't Tell.
The US military is a huge organisation and there will be challenges ahead, but they need to make sure that they've got enough safety nets to protect vulnerable people. In those early days of coming out in the workforce, that it's a pretty awkward, difficult time. And I think as long as they're mindful of that, and it's a continual developmental sort of process, then there's absolutely no reason why the US military can't be where Canada, Australia, New Zealand, the UK, France, Belgium, Germany, anybody else who's gone before, who's led the way, so to speak. You know, it's everyone else has proven that it can work.
So we're here in Sydney, and we have the great fortune of meeting one of Australia's most influential leaders, and certainly a leader in our own gay community.
I think being a homosexual was a reason why I was sensitive to discrimination. Discrimination against women, discrimination against people of colour, discrimination against Aboriginal Australians, and discrimination against gays. I don't like it. And if you've tasted it, you don't like it.
You know, you've been with your partner for 40 years.
Yeah, some people say we're like a pair of lesbians.
You are like a pair of lesbians. We strive. We've been together for almost 3 years. We'd love
to celebrate
it for you.
What is too close?
Are you gone?
Okay.
Is it on? I stopped biting my nails. I've bitten my nails my entire life. And for the past 4 weeks, I haven't bitten my nails, and this is the longest I've ever seen them.
I don't even think I would recognize your hands.
The sad thing is, we're getting more and more unattractive as the days go on. Sometimes I still shock myself when I look in the mirror. Oh my God. And I said,
I brought 4 shirts with me on this trip.
And she wears the same 4 every day.
And
she
it's been so cold that I'm wearing all of them every day.
So yesterday we had a really big interview with Michael Kirby, who is a big shot guy in Australia. And we went in looking like this. He was in a 3-piece suit. And we had our little consumer camcorders. And I'm sure he looked at us like, oh my God. And so it felt a little bit like, oh, we really have to get our act together. When it comes to this video stuff, people ask us, oh, are you guys in TV? And we're like, nope. Are you guys writers? Nope. We're just 2 people who came up with this idea and we're doing it. So there's a lot to learn when it comes to video making. And I'm very, very humbled by the whole process. And I just ordered 3 books on Amazon plus a DVD on how to make a documentary. But I still find the whole thing to be pretty fun. And it's just, you know, learning a new skill, not something that I ever thought I'd try to do, but, you know, why not, right? Why not make a film?
Morning. This is the sound we're hearing from our hostel. All night, mainly, from the roosters.
Indonesia is a vast archipelago of over 17,500 islands. It has the 4th highest population in the world, encompassing many different cultures. Though the nation struggles with poverty, it has an incredible wealth of plant and animal life, including this guy.
We're here in Bali, and we're at the monkey sanctuary, and there's like hundreds of monkeys running around. This shot reminds me of when Jay takes tweezers and tries to pluck my eyebrows. This is what true love is about, picking stuff out of your lover's butt.
Jogja is a city situated in the central part of Java, the most populous of the Indonesian islands. Java has a conservative culture influenced by its large Muslim population.
Open can you be in your life now as a gay man?
Well, I'm totally open actually, but I'm not going to open to my parents. Mm-hmm. Only with my friends here, they know that I'm gay. Mm-hmm. But my parents and family, they don't know.
And what do you think would happen if they did know?
Oh, that will be so hard. I don't know. Let's say they're gonna kill me if they know if I'm gay because they're too religious. Too religious and the region, the Toraja is really cultural. So I don't think so they will accept me. Maybe someday, but maybe take a long time to accept me as a gay.
Indonesians say that LGBT is from West. It's West culture, not Indonesian culture. But I think they're wrong. What's wrong with my love? it's not my love is not fake. I really love my someone special. What's wrong with that? It's not safe. God loves me. With everything that happened in my life, I feel so blessed. Yeah. How could God hate me with all the blessings I got?
Don't get killed.
Lisa says she's drunk.
Actually, I think there's a couple things. I think there's a couple things that we need to adjust to. One is we're eating and drinking as if we're on vacation, but it's been like over a month, and my pants aren't fitting anymore. And then we're also spending money like we're on vacation. And we did our budget recently, and it's not looking too good. So we're gonna have to make some adjustments. But right now, in this moment, I'm enjoying this Singapore Sling drink and the beach.
And why do we not care today?
And today we don't care because it's Jenny's birthday. So we're living it up. She's 30. I mean, how many times do you get to celebrate a decade birthday together? So, yeah. Happy birthday, baby. My mom grew up in the Philippines, and she lived there until she was 9. It's been really sad that Jenni doesn't know, has never met my mom. My mom died before Jenni met her, and I think my mom would have loved Jenni. Having a life partner who's never met someone as important as your mom is actually really hard. So the best way I could let Jenni know who my mom was to bring her back to the Philippines.
So this is the town proper, and this is the public market that has been here for many, many years. Mm. And this is where the house was, the old house.
Huh.
Here.
So this is it?
This is the house, yeah. Where your grandparents and your parents as well live for some time.
We grew up here, and this one was bought by the police. This is Odik.
You come to the world of small people.
Jenni and Lisa meet one of the most prominent celebrities in the Philippines, Ricky Reyes. Ricky was named a top philanthropist in Asia by Forbes magazine. To the people of the Philippines, he is simply known as Mother Ricky.
And that word mother have evolved now, and it doesn't speak to me as mother, as gay, but they call me mother. It's probably because of the things I do for the poor. I have big and high hopes for everyone, not necessarily for gay alone. I think that being gay, being lesbian, being a man and a woman are all the same. It's just how you make your life.
Twenty years before Ellen DeGeneres came out on an American sitcom, Manny Castaneda was playing gay roles on Filipino television.
The gays in the Philippines, they are very, very tolerated, but not accepted. They are like pet dogs, what you would call a status symbol. If you have a fabulous gay friend, they become the court jesters in high society. So that's the difference between being accepted and being tolerated.
So what are your hopes for the community here? What would you like to see happen?
Well, like what all the gays all over the world, equal.
Although the LGBT community has steadily been gaining greater visibility in the media, the Philippines still does not offer any legal recognition to same-sex marriages, civil unions, or domestic partnerships.
Honey, what's going on? How do you feel?
It's just been a bad day. It's been a rare, but very bad day.
got into a fight. We started blaming each other for everything that went wrong. We were very uncomfortable in the humidity and the heat. And we're in a shithole of a hostel. And we realized that, you know, we're not the 18-year-old backpackers that we once were. Who can deal? We discovered we're a little bit more bougie than we thought.
After a frustrating night at the hostel, Jenni and Lisa escaped to paradise on Boracay Island, where Jenni has a little surprise waiting for Lisa.
We just got engaged.
We did?
What just happened?
I asked Lisa to marry me.
Ironically, Lisa was planning to propose to Jenni later in the trip. After the surprise proposal, Lisa got down on one knee and asked Jenni to marry her back. For the past 2 months, both had secretly been travelling with engagement rings.
I mean, it's hard when, you know, only half of your family support you. So I know why it's been hard to be excited to get married, but it's just very exciting to me that you proposed. And, you know, it feels really nice not to be lonely and to feel that we have a lot to look forward to. So I've looked a long time for you. I feel like I was single for a long time. And I never thought it would be this good.
It's so natural. Like, it's the next thing for us. And I think we both in our hearts had already made this commitment. You know, I mean, really, we gave up the apartment, my apartment, and we combined our finances and we left our jobs and we're totally dependent on each other. Because we're on the other side of the world, we don't know anyone. And so I feel like in all those ways, it was already leading up to this point. And it's nice to just be able to say it. You know, it's kind of sad because my own family can't be happy for me in this way. And it's been hard. That part's been hard. But I am very grateful and thankful that Lisa's family has just been so open to me and just has totally accepted me and is happy for me and Lisa to be together. And I also just couldn't think of a more beautiful place for us right now than to be here.
Most of my family still lives in Taipei. My grandparents live there, I have aunts and uncles and cousins there, and my parents, after having lived in the States for about 30 or so years, recently went back to Taipei to retire there. So bringing Lisa to Taiwan is really exciting, but also really scary.
In Taipei, Jenni and Lisa decide to upgrade to a shiny new camera. But there's just one problem. They can't figure out how to turn the autofocus off.
Well, first of all, I really like the food. Man, this thing just keeps going. Why? You keep moving like that, you crazy bull. Well, we're here for 2 weeks and thrilled to be in an apartment. I actually think that this bed is the nicest mattress we've been on for months.
Yeah, that's pretty bad. I'm gonna have you do it over some of that stuff over again because it is just going crazy.
Yeah. You're looking at me? Are you focusing in on me? This thing's gonna drive me crazy.
Camera.
I think we made a mistake.
I've been seeing my family a lot. I've probably seen them at least 4 or 5 times over the past 2 weeks, so poor Lisa's been at home all the time.
Janae's mom is very adamant and insistent that I not attend any family functions.
Every time they ask me, do I have a boyfriend, I have to say no. And then they tell me I should get married because I'm 30 and that's old. And so there's a lot of that going on. It's also hard because I feel like Lisa is really pushing me to just tell my parents or to really push the envelope, but it's just the last thing I want to do.
I just hope for us that things can change in the future. I mean, it's, you know, we're so excited to have these engagement rings now. And it really is painful to see Jenni have to take off her engagement ring before she goes to see her family. I mean, that just sucks. That really, really sucks.
There's just gay people everywhere here in Taiwan. It's nice to run into gay couples on the subway or just kind of walking around in daily life.
Jin Jin Bookstore is the first gay bookstore in the Chinese-speaking world. The goal of Jin Jin is to promote change through culture and to provide a space free from discrimination for the LGBT community.
在京津的立场，我们还是真的很希望去促进更多文化的形式，因为我觉得文化的沟通其实是最好的方式，才会让更多人潜移默化，就是一点一点的去改变、去了解。因为有的时候人会有歧视或者是对立，是因为他还不了解，他把自己封闭。如果我们透过文化的力量一点一点，甚至有一些文化的形式，它很多种，比如说展览、创作。 电影、文学就是书籍文学，其实它都是一种文化的力量。因为你文化改变，你的法律又有了规范之后，它才可以是 match
Jenni and Lisa had planned to come to Shanghai's Gay Pride, but miss it by just 1 week. Out of fear of being shut down, Pride organizers don't announce the dates for the festival until right before the event.
We started off with Yahoo group mailing list. Just started organizing get-togethers, parties, dinners, just hanging out with friends. And then 2 years ago in 2009, one of the founders decided, hey, we definitely have to have Pride in China, and that's how we got started.
We had to be very clear from day one that this is not a protest, it's not a march, it's not a demonstration. And then we also looked around at some of the other pride movements that have come up around Southeast Asia.
The first year I have a friend who bring his mom to this pride event, and then she was really open, supportive, and then she's, I mean, she didn't really understand in the beginning, but she willing to come to the events to know, to learn. I think that's a very big process. I hope one day my mom can support me like that as well. So that's really warmed my heart. In China, the biggest issue for LGBT community is the parents. So it's really nice for us to see there's more parents coming to supporting us, and this shows the understanding.
This is Zhang Qi, a local Shanghai resident who started a Chinese lesbian website in 2001.
那个时候，就是中国大陆就很少，就是女同志网站、拉拉的网站。那我当时就一直运作，大概运作了六年这个网站，然后就认识了很多朋友。就是那个时候在网络上，当然没有现在的网络那么活跃，可是那个时候也已经是，我觉得也还蛮多人。Because
of her experience online, Zhang Qi was inspired to start up a lesbian group called Shanghai Nii, where like-minded people gather to share ideas. Zhang Qi invites Jenni and Lisa to speak to the group.
其实我们知道就是在我们可能我们自己的家庭没办法接受我们，所以这更让我们这些同志就变成like a second
family，就是第二个家庭一样。 Taking advantage of China's vast fashion districts, Jenni steals away to shop for a special item.
So far, this is our most miserable travel experience. It's taking 3 different flights to get the distance from Shanghai to Kathmandu, which really isn't that far. Permits for our long-term trek, and we're filling out the registration form. And we noticed that for under gender, there is male, female, and third gender. So we were excited about that. But we're not excited about our ride.
Because I wanted to trek. Ever since I read the book Into Thin Air, I had this fascination with the mountains, and I've had some opportunity to do some trekking on my own like 10 years ago. So we did 2 treks here, and we were up in the Himalayas, and it was awesome.
Despite widespread poverty and a decade-long civil war, Nepal has made significant strides for LGBT rights in recent years. One of the key figures in Nepal's fight for equal rights is Bhumika Shrestha.
Most of the I'm proud. I'm a transgender people. I'm so proud of my life. So on to the 21st December 2007, the Supreme Court gave the decision for Nepal government. To give a transgender identity card and same-sex marriage.
Bhumika is a member of the Blue Diamond Society. Founded in 2001, their goal is to promote a society where each sexual and gender minority can live with equal rights and dignity. The founder of the Blue Diamond Society, Sunil Pant, is the first openly gay member of the Nepali Parliament and one of the leaders in the landmark 2007 Supreme Court decision.
I thought there would be a positive outcome.
So we expected like maybe 10%, but they gave us 100%.
Yeah. And why do you think that?
I did not realize the judiciary is more progressive compared to the society and the government and culture. I thought gay people are rare in this country, in this culture. That's what I was taught, I was told. Without struggle, without raising voice, the movement was never been successful anywhere. So we need to speak up.
Thanksgiving tomorrow here, and I think we're just, I know I'm a little homesick.
Anyways, we want to kill each other sometimes. Yeah. I think we spend way too much time together, and we need a break.
We need a break this morning for sure.
Yeah.
No seats on the bus, so they toss us on the roof. We have a 3-hour ride. We have some new friends with us and a goat. Let the adventure begin.
Largest mosques. When we entered through, they made every woman put on this gorgeous gown that covers our unholy bodies. For the first time, Lisa actually won out. Yeah, she didn't have to wear one. They thought she was a dude.
I've been struggling. I think every day it's like a decision what to wear. You know, I kind of go through this thing where I'm like, do I wear a sports bra because it's really hot and I'm moving around a lot? Or do I wear a padded bra so that I can push my boobs out a little bit more? I never liked wearing dresses. I mean, ever. I was such a tomboy. I always like used to throw these big fights with my parents about going shopping, and I wanted to shop in the boys' department, and they wouldn't let me. A lot of it is just trying to build my own self-confidence to be like, Lisa, okay, you're not wearing this shirt because you want to look like a man. You're wearing it because it's just your style. You like it. It's you. I'm just trying to be me. I'm really just trying to be me and be confident as me. How's my hair look? Am I going to wow them? I often get the feeling that people are talking about me behind my back, and that never feels good. You see glances and people stare. It's just better sometimes to keep quiet. And that's really hard.
I went to the monastery was, I discovered that there isn't a place for gay people. You know, Asian communities are not based on individuals. They're based on collectivities like family, community. And if you're gay, you can't get married. And if you're honest to yourself, you don't get married to a woman. And if you don't get married and you don't have children and don't raise a family, there is a problem for you. That's when I went to the monastery. And the surprising thing is in the monastery, they said, we know you're gay. I said, yes, I am gay. So why are you inside? You should go out and fight it out.
What do you think Westerners need to know about India and Asian gay movement?
The first thing, and that's a very big thing, is this is a non-Judeo-Christian civilization. The civilization that didn't have the devil and didn't have homophobia. What they did have was a patriarchal system. We call it Purush Pradhan, which means men in front.
Common enemy outside is patriarchy and the whole notion of male privilege with which men operate. If you are a man and you're a homosexual and it's known and you're getting penetrated in the sexual act, then you're doing something which is unmanly. You're doing something which, like, you know, makes you fall from that pedestal of manhood. And therefore, you are not a man. You are something less than a man. What is less than a man? You like a woman. We need to change that. Empowerment in India should be about actually ensuring proper gender equality, where the woman's status is established in society so that the gay man's status also simultaneously gets affirmed. That is going to have an effect.
In 2001, Aditya was part of a legal team that drafted a petition in the New Delhi High Court, challenging the constitutionality of India's anti-sodomy law. This petition resulted in the High Court decriminalizing homosexuality in India in 2009.
What the case really did is it helped disparate groups across India that were trying to do their own little things. It helped bring everybody together by way of a national movement, which was focused on this common enemy called 377, which was happening in Delhi.
This is Prince Manvendra, the world's first openly gay prince. He gained worldwide fame when he appeared on Oprah in 2006.
I felt that there was a lot of need to break this stigma and discrimination which is existing in our society. And that kind of instigated me to come out openly and talk about myself, whether we are gay, we are lesbian, we are transgender, bisexual, or whatever sexual minority we come from, we have to all unite and fight for our rights. Gay rights cannot be won in the courtrooms, but in the hearts and the minds of the people.
So today is Christmas Eve, and I'm definitely homesick. This doesn't feel the same here in Udaipur, where no one knows it's even Christmas.
Takes them a long time to pick up, usually.
Hello?
Oh. Hey, Dad.
Hey. Lisa.
Yeah, Happy New Year.
Happy New Year to you. How are you doing?
Good. How are you doing?
Okay. What's going on?
Not much. Thought I would give you a call. We're just leaving India and headed to Africa in a couple hours.
Good. Thank God.
Yeah.
When are you coming home?
I'm coming home in 6 months. We're halfway.
Oh, my God. 6 months.
Yeah, we
six
had
months?
6 months. Well, but did the last 6 months go by pretty quick?
Yeah, well, I guess so.
Yeah.
6 months. Seems like a long time. It seems like a long time.
I know.
Okay, good.
Okay.
I can't wait.
All right, Dad. I love you lots.
Love you too. Bye.
Wow, he sounded great today. That was like a 5-minute phone call.
We're in Africa!
What are we doing in Africa?
We're gonna climb a mountain.
Lisa's best friend and doppelganger, Krista, joins them in Tanzania. Their goal, to climb the highest mountain in Africa, Mount Kilimanjaro.
So we learned a new word in Swahili.
Mapacha, which means twins.
And no one can tell us apart. So we've just decided to accept that we're twins. And we're telling everyone
everybody.
That.
Why not? Two heat pads on my mittens, two heat pads on my feet, and two heat pads around my belly. I had two in my bra, but that was a little bit too much. I had to take those off.
Just a little boob sweat.
Yeah. Right now we're having positive mental attitude. This is going to be the best night of our lives. It's going to be so awesome.
Yeah.
It's gonna be so- I can't wait. I mean, who doesn't want to walk at like 2 a.m. in the freezing cold?
Yeah. I'm just hoping that my body will just enter mania stage and it'll just be okay, you know? Like, it'll just take over adrenaline, no problem.
So, we made it. Oh, we made it. Poor Jenni, about 2 hours ago, started to have blurry vision. So she wasn't able to make it to the peak, but you know, the destination is always about the journey, and she was with us this whole time. She made it until she started to lose her eyesight. So I'm glad that she stopped, and I'm very happy to be here. It's always been my dream, and I'm just very, very, very happy.
I sent out about 50 emails to international organizations, to journalists, to gay media, to anyone who was covering Africa, asking for contacts throughout Tanzania, and I've come up with zero. I mean, I actually had three different activists from Kenya introduce me via email to people in Tanzania, but I was unable to get any interviews or responses. So that alone tells me that there's just not safety for anyone here.
95% of Tanzanians do not accept homosexuality. Homosexual acts are crimes punishable by the state in Tanzania. Sexual acts between men carry a maximum penalty of life imprisonment. Sexual acts between women are not even mentioned in Tanzanian law.
Hello, Mom and Dad. I have been working on a letter to you guys for a while. And I thought that instead of sending it to you, I would just read it to you.
I made a video to tell my parents that I'm getting engaged, and I have put it up on YouTube, but I haven't sent them the link. I haven't sent them the letter yet. And obviously there's a big part of me that's dreading doing that because I just think it's gonna be hard for them to take. And I really don't feel like dealing with their reaction. But I also wanna do it early enough before we get home so they have a couple months to just chew on it.
It's just really hard and it causes her family a lot of pain, and her brother's getting engaged as well. And so she has this constant parallel between watching her parents be really excited about her brother's wedding and then, you know, having this dooming news that her parents are gonna disapprove of every commitment step that we take.
I'm ready and I know that Lisa's the right person, and I'm excited to spend the rest of my life with her, and I'm excited to build our house together and have a family together, but just thinking about the wedding, like, it's just not something that I'm very excited about.
A lot of weddings have slideshows, and like, what's the point of a slideshow? It's so you can show all these baby pictures and these childhood pictures, and then your aunts and uncles can laugh and they can say, oh my gosh, I remember Jenni when you were so little and so cute, and now look at you now. And then your parents can say, oh yeah, I remember when you had braces and when your hair was permed out. And then you have your junior high school friends and your high school friends, and you could talk about how you went to camp. And I think about my community now and the people who would be there at my wedding, and almost all the people who have shared that history in the past with me won't be there. You know, my parents won't be there. My grandparents won't be there. My elementary school friends won't be there. The people I went to church camp with, where I spent so many summers and have so many photos of, they won't be there. And that makes me sad, because the whole point of a slideshow is so that people in the audience can say, hey, I remember when. And it makes me sad to feel like I don't have that.
I know that Jenni loves me. I know that Jenni wants to marry me. I don't have any doubt in her commitment to me. I just want to have a good time and celebrate, and it sucks. I actually don't blame Jenni. I actually kind of blame society and homophobic values, and it's an institutional homophobia that, you know, it has never allowed us to be little kids and kind of think about our big gay wedding when we grew up.
This is my story.
This is my song, praising my Savior, oh God alone. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior, oh God alone.
Kenya is a country with a history of intolerance towards LGBT people. In 2011, a study revealed that 89% of people who came out to their families were disowned. Homosexual acts are considered crimes.
Oh, look at those tomatoes. Hello, how are you? Do you mind if I take a picture? Or no?
No.
No, okay.
There are, however, several individuals working to improve the lives of gay Kenyans. Among them is Reverend Michael Kamindu, the founder of Other Sheep Africa. Reverend Kamindu started Other Sheep to fight religious-based homophobia and provide a safe haven for LGBT people.
I looked at the book of John, chapter 10. I came across verse 16, where it says, I have other sheep, which are not of this flock, of this pen. I will look for them, they will hear my voice, and we shall be one flock and one shepherd.
Okay, what does it say?
They called me a gay pastor. Yes, I serve gay people, but I'm not gay. You hear the claim that homosexuality is not African, it is Western. If the religious leader said, wait a minute, even without the West, we had gay people in Africa, which is true, but they don't want to accept. If they did, the government would have no problem with the homosexuality. In fact, it would be a thing of the past. People will say, these are our children, these are our people, we've always had them in the society, let us give them peace.
Reverend Kamindu's work has come at a cost, as both he and his Other Sheep co-founder, John McCoker, have lost their congregations because of their inclusion of LGBT people.
Most of our LGBTI persons are living in the closet, are living in fear. Some have even lost their lives. Some are dead spiritually because of what they normally hear from their religious leaders. So what we are doing as Other Sheep Africa Kenya is to go out and have what we call educational awareness seminars. We sit down and dialogue and look at what the Bible really says and doesn't say about human sexuality.
These Africans are remarkable. You know, their dedication to the cause is so above and beyond because their life is at risk.
GALC was constituted at least just to create awareness, you know, which is very broad. Yeah, but, you know, just knowing that these are people and they need to be treated as people. That was now the key mandate. And also just offering a safe and enabling environment for the LGBTI people to come together, share, interact, that support that they do not get at home.
Both in Uganda and Kenya, for instance, we've remained a very closed society. We've not allowed ourselves to debate, to dialogue, to discuss issues surrounding sex, sexuality. And that means people have a very shallow understanding of what sexual orientation is. They haven't allowed themselves to really explore sexuality, so it's no wonder they don't understand it.
I'm running for the Senate, Kiambu County, and in the upcoming elections, hopefully in December.
David Kuria is Kenya's first openly gay Senate candidate. His campaign has been incredibly difficult, as religious fanatics have issued multiple public death threats.
At that point, I was really, really scared because they were actually asking for me to be killed. And yeah, there are some people out there who'd do it and they would feel that they're doing a religious obligation.
The salvation for any country is with the youth, with the younger population, because they will usher in, you know, an era where You can discuss anything. You can talk about anything. And once you start getting involved in discussions, then you basically started the process of people understanding.
Like the Chinese say, that the journey of 1,000 miles starts with the first step. And to me, and to others, my colleagues who are in the movement, we are saying, we have started the first step. And I'm sure we will play our role up to a certain level.
You say, with the time, we are going to get there. And so I should not fear to be a pioneer.
They told me that they received the video, and they said that they've been really busy, and I don't think they wanted to get in confrontation over the phone. What do they think they're going to say? I think they're going to say that they are upset and sad at my choices. I think they're going to say that they love me. I think they're going to say that they can only see me individually, and I don't think they're going to come to the wedding. And I think they're going to say that they're just not ready. They just can't do it. That's what I think they're going to say.
Especially after East Africa.
Brazil is home to one of the largest LGBT festivals in the world. In 1993, Andre Fischer created Mix Brazil, a festival of cinema, theatre, music and literature.
In the second year of the festival, we wanted to create a word that would mean gay-friendly, because there was not such a word in Portuguese, in Brazilian Portuguese. So we created this expression, GLS. So adding gay, lesbian, and simpatizante, so sympathizers. We have a very strong evangelical community. They're fighting to allow psychiatrists to cure gays. The only way that maybe a homosexual can be accepted in smaller cities, it's becoming a transvestite. That's why there's so many transvestites in smaller cities. It's harder for people in smaller cities to understand a gay man than a transvestite. And that's where people are killed in these smaller cities.
Okay, we'll be here outside. We just hired our first translator for the project. Portuguese really doesn't sound anything like Spanish, and we've been at a loss the last few days. So luckily, we found someone in the last 24 hours who's gonna help facilitate our interview with Jane.
Jean Willis is Brazil's second openly gay member of parliament. He rose to fame after winning the fifth season of Big Brother Brazil and has used his popularity to fight for gay rights in his country.
Difícil definir o Brasil, porque ao mesmo tempo que nós temos uma imagem pública lá fora de que nós somos um paraíso tropical, nós somos liberados sexualmente, nós somos temos uma miscigenação incrível, ao mesmo tempo que há esse discurso, na prática, nas relações aqui, o Brasil ainda é um país racista e um país homofóbico. Ele apresentou um projeto de lei que legaliza as terapias de cura para homossexuais. É um horror, porque essas terapias incidem em prática de tortura psicológica e física. E eu tenho me enfrentado esse projeto de lei bastante, tenho discursado bastante contra ele, me articulado bastante para derrubá-lo, para não fazê-lo ser, que ele seja aprovado, impedir que ele seja aprovado. Parte das nossas do impedimento, parte significativa do que impede as nossas conquistas políticas e culturais é a homofobia internalizada. O que é a homofobia internalizada? É quando o gay introjeta o próprio discurso contra ele, quando ele não consegue passar da vergonha para o orgulho, se assumir, ter orgulho de si e se reconhecer como uma classe que precisa se unir e lutar para conquistar os seus direitos.
Maria Rashid is the former president of Federación Argentina LGBT, an organization that began over 20 years ago to promote acceptance and stop discrimination of LGBT people in Argentina.
A partir de este momento, todas las personas son iguales ante la ley, cosa que ya en realidad garantizaba la Constitución Nacional, y a partir de la sanción del matrimonio igualitario se hace realidad esto de la igualdad para las parejas y para las familias del mismo sexo. Ese mensaje por parte del Estado lo que hace es cambiar la percepción de la gente en muchos sentidos. Yo siempre digo que en realidad los efectos del matrimonio igualitario no son solamente para las parejas que se casan, son para un montón de personas que aunque no se casen nunca, van a ser percibidas por los compañeros de trabajo, por la familia, por los vecinos, de otra manera a partir de este mensaje de igualdad del Estado nacional. Me siento muy orgullosa de Argentina porque Argentina hoy es un modelo de igualdad y ojalá muy pronto tengamos en todo el mundo los mismos derechos con los mismos nombres.
Perfecto, perfecto. Yeah. She's incredible. She's just badass. She's really very well spoken, very cool woman. So that was a real pleasure to meet her.
Now what's next?
Next, I don't know.
While Jenni and Lisa were in South America, Argentina adopted the gender identity law, which enables people to change their names and sexes on official documents without first getting approval from a judge or doctor. No other country in the world allows people to change their legal gender based on how they identify. This law made Argentina a world leader in transgender rights. Kalim Soria is the president of a local trans advocacy group made up of 40 trans men like himself.
No venimos a ocupar el lugar de los hombres porque somos orgullosos hombres trans. Solo queremos que nos den un espacio para poder existir, porque tenemos familias, tenemos hijos. Queremos tener todo lo que tienen todos, nada más. Para eso, el tema de la ley de identidad de género. ¿Por qué? Porque es la puerta abierta al resto de los derechos. Entonces, es la mejor ley. Creo que es el antecedente para toda Latinoamérica.
Hello.
Way.
Yes.
Happy birthday, Dad.
Thank you.
Hello, Nia.
Hello, Mom.
Hey, 打电话给 Daddy 生日快乐啊。
对。I just hate talking. I hate
I know I should be talking about some stuff, bring it up in conversation, but I just hate talking about it. Okay?
Okay.
College, back in 2001, I signed up for a volunteer program for 2.5 years that randomly sent me to Chile. I'm really excited to show Jenni where I got my start as an HIV social worker in a place that was really important to me. We're here, and this is where I lived in Chile for 2.5 years. This is my house. I lived here with 4 other volunteers from the States. 10 years ago, it was very different to live here in Chile and be gay. I was out to my American program and my American roommates and coworkers, but not out to my Chilean coworkers or the Catholic organization for which I was working. Those 2.5 years were fun, but very different and very hard at times.
Cuando tú llegaste, feliz, pues, estamos todos felices. Y después, a medida que te fuimos conociendo, tomamos cariño, ya le pasaste a ser parte de nosotros, nuestros amigos eran tus amigos, te atendíamos como una hija.
¿Alguna vez habían pensado que yo era lesbiana antes de que te conté?
Yo tenía una leve impresión.
Yo
tuve una leve impresión y se lo comenté al Claudio. Y el Claudio me decía, no, no.
Acá no me hemos fijado en el color, si soy negro, soy flaco, soy gordo.
Claro.
Soy amarillo, verde.
Nos preocupamos de la persona,
claro.
Cómo es.
Siempre ser como somos.
Eso es lo más importante para nosotros.
In 2012, 25-year-old Daniel Zamudio was brutally murdered in Chile. His death sparked protests all around Latin America and put a face on homophobic violence.
Socio de la organización Arica LGBT.
¿Cómo empezaron ustedes?
Bueno, nosotros nos estamos organizando hace poco, más o menos hace como más de un mes. Nos motivó la muerte de Daniel Zamudio y además que somos la única organización que la estamos poniendo acá en Arica.
¿Puedo caminar con ustedes?
Sí, obviamente, caminen, si esta marcha es para todos. Acá nadie se siente discriminado. Acá tenemos que todos luchar, unirnos y luchar contra la discriminación.
Tuvo la muerte de Daniel fue de tal magnitud porque la brutalidad de la acción en contra de este chico demostró a la sociedad chilena en su conjunto las dimensiones que puede alcanzar la homofobia. Sabe que, porque conoce la historia de otros movimientos sociales, y que cuando un grupo humano, en este caso las minorías sexuales, empiezan a alcanzar o están en el umbral de alcanzar igualdad ante la ley, la violencia se vuelve más extrema en contra de estos grupos. Pasó con el movimiento contra el apartheid en Sudáfrica, pasó con el movimiento de los derechos civiles de la población de raza negra en Estados Unidos, cuando estaban a punto de conseguir derecho, igualdad ante la ley, la violencia se agudizó. Creo que este país, a pesar de situaciones tan dolorosas como la del Daniel, es una sociedad que cada día mejora.
Just got an email from my dad that's titled President Obama. Dear daughter, yesterday President Obama made an important political announcement. He backs gay marriage. I think this is important to you and want to talk about it. We have been avoiding this topic with you recently, and it became one of the reasons we don't want to come back to the Bay Area early. Your plan of lesbian marriage is your choice. I can't stop you. What worries me is the question, will you be happy? I just want to let you know that one man, one woman marriage may not be the perfect marriage. However, the difference between us becomes a perfect compensation to this imperfect marriage. I want you to be happy and have a good relationship with us, your family. Will you be happy with your choice? Dad, keep this email between you and me only. I don't want Mom to know. Well, I want to write back and tell him that I love him and that I'm grateful that he's worried about my happiness. That's, I feel like, the first time I feel like that's what he's most worried about. So I want to tell him I'm happy. I mean, I wish he could see how happy Lisa makes me. And I wish he could see how good she is for me and how much she's made me balance, and she complements my strengths with her strengths, and how much she listens to me and supports me and gives me the space that I need to be the person that I am and helps me through my insecurities and my feelings of loneliness. And she has confidence in me, and she really sees the best in me, and I wish that he could see that. As strongly as I feel that, you know, my perspective is the right one and that in many ways they have wronged me, I'm sure that they feel the exact same way about me. Some of my friends or some people would say, you know what, just stop talking to them or stop trying. And yeah, I mean, sure, I've heard plenty of stories of gay people who just don't talk to their parents for 10 years, you know? I mean, like, what good is that gonna do? They're stuck in a mindset that's hard to change after 50 years. But at least my dad is trying. My mom just won't even talk to me.
Here we are. Machu Picchu.
Any feelings about this trek?
This is the last trek of the year. So I think we're okay not trekking for a while.
Are you ready to go home?
I'm completely ready to go home. If I could catch a flight right now to go home, I would take it.
A 2010 poll revealed that only 21% of Peruvians approved of same-sex marriage. Although Peru has made steps towards equality, such as gays and lesbians being allowed to serve openly in the military and the right to change your legal gender, same-sex marriage is still illegal there. One of the groups fighting to bring equality to Peru is Movimiento Homosexual de Lima.
So here at Mobile, they estimate that once a week there's a death in Peru based on hate crimes. One for every week.
As their journey comes to an end, Lisa reflects on their international search for equality and the leaders they have met along the way.
I think that the biggest things happening in the global gay movement are momentum. Momentum that people are feeling from other countries. So, you know, when Argentina passes their marriage equality laws, Chile wants to pass their marriage equality laws. When Nepal allows for same-sex marriage and third gender identity recognition, India wants to strike down their anti-homosexual acts. I think that's the biggest thing that's happening. I think the voices of LGBT people are getting stronger, and they're getting stronger
because they have models and because they have examples of healthy gay people living in different parts of the world and because they have support of other countries. In the end, love is gonna win out. I mean, we're not going to lose this battle. It's just a matter of time. It's really just a matter of time. Together. One year, we never got robbed. We never had anything bad happen. We had an amazing year. And now we have to go home.
Now we're home.
She says, I smell like safety and home. I named both of her eyes forever and please don't go. I could be your morning sunrise all the time, yeah. This could be good, this could be good. I can't change even if I try, even if I. She keeps me warm. She keeps me warm.